Can you explain how interdisciplinary research has contributed to the structural resolution of the ribosome?
Well, the first thing I could say is that at the Nobel Prizes in 2009, the physics prize was given for the development of CCD detectors and for the development of fiber optics, which, you know, allows large amounts of data to be moved. Now, the interesting thing is that the X-ray detectors that we used to solve the structure of the ribosome at the time were based on CCD detectors. So you could see right away how developments in physics had helped, you know, solve an important problem in biology using a sort of, you know, physical method. So in that sense, interdisciplinary work is extremely important in that discoveries made in one field will often be used to drive other fields. My own field, which is structural biology, is intrinsically interdisciplinary because it involves using physical techniques to attack biological problems. Sometimes what people mean by interdisciplinary is when people from different disciplines come together to attack a problem that neither of them could by themselves. And that can often happen spontaneously. You know, people who require analysis of data might go to a mathematician or a computer scientist and say, look, you know, I have this large-scale data and I don't know how to extract the information from it. And then, you know, they might collaborate. Or if you want to do a particular sort of experiment, but you need some novel technique to attack it, you might go and talk to a physicist or a physical chemist, and they might say, well, actually, if you were to use this technique, it might help you obtain the kind of information you're looking for. So I think one has to be open-minded and encourage interdisciplinary work where it's needed. And that means lowering barriers to interdisciplinary work. But I'm not one of these missionaries who thinks that interdisciplinary work is always the answer or it should be promoted over everything else. That's just not the way science works. Some science is not interdisciplinary and it's absolutely first rate and it's making great advances. And other science, you know, by definition, is interdisciplinary. Science shouldn't be wedded to particular models. Rather, its goal is to not inhibit interactions. If there's a barrier between talking to physicists and chemists and engineers and so on, that's not a good thing. But if you remove these barriers, then things will happen, you know, spontaneously as needed.
And speaking of collaboration, can you talk about the importance of international cooperation and research?
Well, I think for many things, collaboration is essential. I mean, we ourselves are now collaborating with two groups. We've been collaborating with one group at the NIH on initiation of translation in yeast for certainly over 15 years. And we've begun a collaboration with how this process works in human ribosomes with a group in California. These groups provide complementary expertise. We're, you know, focused on solving structures, but they have a lot of biochemical expertise and they can also do genetics. So, you know, there is quite a lot of natural collaboration. But then there's also other collaborations, such as collaboration that involves very large-scale work, like the Human Genome Project was a very large-scale collaboration, or you know, the discovery of the Higgs boson involved scientists from many different countries working at CERN, you know, to attack this rather difficult problem, or the discovery of gravitational waves involved you know, scientists from lots of different countries, and in fact even equipment was based in lots of different countries to obtain a result. So science can vary from you know, very small scale independent efforts which require no collaboration, but simply require, you know, one or few scientists to be really quite original and do their thing, to others which require large scale collaboration. There isn't a one size fits all model for science. And I think we shouldn't try to impose collaboration. That's not the way science works. In some cases, you'll need it. In other cases, individuals working even by themselves are going to make major contributions.
So could you talk about then the role of government on long-term investment in basic research?
I think, you know, governments invest in research because they know that it's good for the economy. Most Western countries prosper not because of cheap labor or raw materials, but because of knowledge. And if you look at the growth of Europe, you know, for most of history, China and India were among the top, you know, economic countries in the world. And suddenly you see in the 1700s and 1800s, Europe emerging as a big powerhouse and becoming the world's largest economy, and then was taken over by the US around the early 1900s. And all of this has to do with the idea that knowledge is important for economic growth, you know, and it's what drives economic growth. And governments all realize that, but governments are under pressure. They want to spend money, but they also want to know what can you get out of it. And what governments need to realize is that virtually everything that you see today as part of driving the economy, you know, major parts of the economy, they all came out of some basic curiosity-based research. I mean, if you look at something as simple as electricity, Michael Faraday, when he was discovering the laws of induction, didn't have the idea that it's going to become a multi-trillion dollar industry worldwide, okay? And it's the same with batteries, you know, or you know, if you look at these video cameras, you know, and you look at all of the inventions that go into a digital camera, the computers, the CCD chips, all of these things came out of basic science. It's the same with medicine, you know, a fundamental understanding of physiology and cell biology and genetics has led to transformative, you know, things in medicine, advances in medicine. So what I would argue is that, yes, it's very important to take basic research and make sure that it's used for applications, and that applications are developed, that they're commercialized in a way that, you know, benefits everybody. But it's also important to realize that the future transformations in the economy are going to come out of the basic science of today. And so we have to realize that a fraction of the research budget must always be set aside for very fundamental research, because we have no idea what it'll lead to. I mean, the idea that high-energy physicists at CERN, you know, because they wanted to share data, invented a protocol that now results in the World Wide Web, you know, it was not predictable, okay? It happened because of fundamental investment in fundamental science. So I think governments need to always keep that in mind. And just as a farmer always has to set aside seed corn for next year's harvest, you know, you don't want to use it all up.
And so how can we convince then governments to, especially in some developing countries, including resource-rich countries, to invest in fundamental research?
Well, I think we in Britain are doing a fairly good job. And I think in the US, there's always been a recognition, you know, that, for example, the National Institutes of Health, which is really for medical research, yet invests a huge amount of money in basic science, you know. So I think there is a recognition. I wouldn't say that there isn't, but I think there is a danger. There are other countries which, you know, don't see the value of basic science, you know, and I think they're mistaken. They will never become first-rate economies unless they invest in a healthy mix of basic and applied science. Countries like Singapore, South Korea, China, they've all, you know, invested in basic research, also starting from nowhere. You know, they also started from, you know, very little. There's very little research going on in all three of these countries, and they're all big powerhouses now, you know. So I think it requires a, you know, enlightened leadership at the top, and it requires them to then hire good scientists, you know, first-rate scientists, maybe even from the West or returned from the West. But then they've got to give them independence and they have to trust them. And that's sometimes hard for some countries.
Public engagement in science. Why is it important?
Well, it's important for two reasons. One is, I think the fundamental reason is science is part of our culture. You know, it's part of the culture of humanity that we know things. We know, for example, you know, how we actually inherit, you know, traits. I mean, at the molecular level, that was amazing. You know, for centuries, no one understood why children were more similar to their parents than, you know, to other people and so on, you know, or why we didn't give birth to animals instead of human beings, right? So nobody understood that. And now, you know, we understand these things at a molecular level. We understand how the universe might have begun, you know, with, you know, the Big Bang and so on. We understand how evolution works. We understand the nature of molecules. People, until the 19th century, didn't even know about molecules. So these are all amazing triumphs of human understanding. You know, if you went back 200 years and told people, you know, we understand how the universe began and the molecular basis of heredity and, you know, how, you know, physiology works and so on, they would think we were magicians, okay? So I think that's one reason, to convey the excitement of science and the knowledge, which is really part of, you know, all of humanity. And the second reason is that in nearly all countries, science is supported by the public through taxes. So it is really our duty as scientists to inform the public what is going on in science. You know, how are we using your money to make discoveries and make advances and, you know, occasionally improving life in various ways? You know, so I think that's just part of our, you know, contract with the public, if you like.